भक्ति भाव और आनंद देखते ही बनता है। उज्जैन में हर सिद्धि मंदिर प्रमुख शक्तिपीठों में शामिल है। हर सिद्धि मंदिर और महाकालेश्वर मंदिर एक दूसरे के सामने स्थित हैं। गढ़कालिका देवी का मंदिर उज्जैन का प्रसिद्ध स्थान है। वे महाकवि कालिदास की आराध्य देवी हैं। वर्तमान मंदिर का निर्माण प्राचीन मंदिर के अवशेषों पर किया गया है। पारंपरिक 64 योगिनी मंदिर भी यहीं स्थित है। प्रसिद्ध काल भैरव मंदिर क्षिप्रा नदी के पार गढ़कालिका मंदिर के पास ही स्थित है। यहां मदिरा का चषक काल भैरव की मूर्ति के होठों पर लगाने पर रिक्त हो जाता है।
और वह जो प्रतिमा है, उस प्रतिमा की ओर से जब वो प्याला लगा दिया जाता है तो मदिरा का मदिरा उसमें से खाली होने लगती है। तो ये जो रहस्य है वो विज्ञान के लिए भी और आस्थावानों के लिए भी, दोनों के लिए एक प्रकार से कौतूहल का विषय है।
विश्व प्रसिद्ध सिद्धवट भैरवगढ़ क्षेत्र में स्थित है, जहां श्रद्धालुजन अपने मृतक परिजनों की औधर्व दैहिक क्रिया संपन्न करते हैं। उज्जैन में बड़ी संख्या में लोग अपने पूर्वजों का तर्पण करने आते हैं। सद्भाव और सर्वधर्म संभाव की नगरी के रूप में प्रसिद्ध उज्जैन मंगलनाथ मंदिर क्षिप्रा के तट पर सिद्धवट के सामने स्थित है। इस मंदिर को मंगल ग्रह के सबसे निकट माना जाता है। इस मंदिर से थोड़ी ही दूर पर अंकपात क्षेत्र में महर्षि सांदीपनी का आश्रम है। पौराणिक विवरण के अनुसार भगवान श्री कृष्ण, उनके भाई बलराम और मित्र सुदामा ने 64 दिन तक यहां शिक्षा प्राप्त की थी।
श्री कृष्ण ने विद्या अध्ययन किया और सांदीपनी आश्रम में उन्होंने 14 विद्या और 64 कलाओं का अध्ययन थोड़े ही समय में पूर्ण कर लिया। यहीं पर श्री कृष्ण की 8 रानियों में से एक रानी मित्रवंदा उज्जैन की थी।
उज्जैन शहर के मुख्य बाजार के बीचों बीच प्रसिद्ध गोपाल मंदिर स्थित है। इस भव्य मंदिर का निर्माण तत्कालीन सिंधिया राजमाता बायजाबाई ने 19वीं सदी के प्रारंभ में कराया था।
उज्जैन शहर के बीच में गोपाल मंदिर का निर्माण रानी बायजाबाई के द्वारा करवाया गया था। ये प्रायः 9 वर्ष में बनकर के तैयार हुआ और ये द्वारकाधीश का मंदिर है जो आज गोपाल मंदिर नाम से प्रसिद्ध है।
नाथ पंथ के संस्थापक गुरु मत्स्येंद्र नाथ की समाधि गढ़कालिका मंदिर के समीप स्थित है। इसी के पास प्रसिद्ध गुफा है जहां राजा भर्तृहरि ने तपस्या की थी। उज्जैन नगरी का एक और बहुत पवित्र स्थल नवग्रह शनि मंदिर है, जो क्षिप्रा, क्षाता या खान नदी के संगम पर स्थित है। यहां शनिवार अमावस्या के दिन बड़ा मेला लगता है। वैशाख के कृष्ण पक्ष में अवंती क्षेत्र की परिक्रमा की जाती है, जहां असंख्य पवित्र स्थल मौजूद हैं। इस यात्रा को 5 कोशी कहा जाता है। वास्तव में ये एक चल महोत्सव है। इस यात्रा में हजारों भक्तगण पैदल चलकर 118 किलोमीटर की दूरी तय करते हैं। क्षिप्रा के तट पर कर्कराजेश्वर मंदिर स्थित है। ये कर्क रेखा का मध्य बिंदु है। इसी कारण खगोलीय और ज्योतिष अध्ययन के क्षेत्र में कालगणना के लिए उज्जैन को विश्व का केंद्र माना जाता है। माना जाता है कि वाराहमिहिर के समय में भी उज्जैन में एक वेधशाला थी। 18वीं सदी के प्रथम भाग में जयपुर के शासक जयसिंह ने उज्जैन में क्षिप्रा के तट पर इसका निर्माण करवाया। जिस बस्ती में ये वेधशाला स्थित है उसका नाम जयसिंहपुरा पड़ गया। सम्राट विक्रमादित्य को ऐसे पहले राजा के रूप में याद किया जाता है जिन्होंने अपने देश को विदेशी शक शासकों से मुक्त कराया। सम्राट ने इस विजय के उपलक्ष्य में विक्रम संवत शुरू किया जो क्राइस्ट से 57 साल पहले की घटना है। विक्रमादित्य की महानता और महत्व को सिंहासन द्वात्रिंशिका में वर्णित किया गया है। इसके अलावा बेताल पंचविशतिका में विक्रमादित्य की न्यायप्रियता और सही एवं त्वरित न्याय देने की दक्षता दर्शाने वाली 25 कहानियां शामिल हैं। उज्जैन में बेताल को समर्पित एक मंदिर भी है।
सम्राट विक्रमादित्य न केवल एक शासकीय महत्ता का व्यक्ति था बल्कि उस समय उसने सांस्कृतिक नवजागरण भी किया और अपनी सभा में उसने ऐसे नवरत्न एकत्र किए जो विभिन्न विषयों के ऐसे विशेषज्ञ थे जिन्होंने जो भी कुछ उस समय लिखा वो आज भी अद्वितीय है।
इनमें से एक वराहमिहिर का जन्म स्थान कपित्थ या कायथा बस्ती उज्जैन के पास स्थित है। महान संस्कृत कवि और नाट्यकार महाकवि कालिदास भी विक्रमादित्य के नौ रत्नों में एक थे। उन्होंने अपनी कालजयी कृति मेघदूतम में उज्जैनी का बड़ा मनोहारी चित्रात्मक वर्णन किया है।
महाकवि कालिदास जो कवि और नाटककार के रूप में सुविख्यात हैं, वो विक्रमादित्य की सभा के एक रत्न थे।
18वीं सदी में नवस्थापित सिंधिया राजवंश ने सबसे पहला काम भव्य महाकाल मंदिर के निर्माण का किया। रानोजी सिंधिया के शासनकाल में रामचंद्र बाबा शेवणी ने महाकाल मंदिर, अन्य मंदिरों और घाटों का निर्माण करवाया। सिंहस्थ 2016 में यहां त्रिवेणी संग्रहालय के रूप में नवीनतम संस्थान की स्थापना हुई। इस संग्रहालय में शैव, वैष्णव और शाक्त परंपराओं को मूर्तियों तथा चित्रों के माध्यम से बहुत आकर्षक ढंग से दर्शाया गया है। लोक नाट्य माच और मालवांचल के पारंपरिक भित्ति चित्र मांडने उज्जैन की बहुत लोकप्रिय पारंपरिक लोक कलाएं हैं।
उज्जैनी सांस्कृतिक स्पंदन का शहर है। यहाँ देश दुनिया के कलाकारों की भागीदारी हुआ करती है। यहाँ अनेक अवसरों पर प्रतिष्ठित कलाकारों का आगमन हुआ है जिन्होंने अपनी साधना और प्रतिभा से अपनी अमिट छाप छोड़ी है।
नमस्कार, मैं भावना व्यास, संस्कृति विभाग के त्रिवेणी कला एवं पुरातत्व संग्रहालय की ओर से पंचमहाभूत आधारित व्याख्यान माला के छठे सत्र में आप सभी का स्वागत करती हूँ। संपूर्ण मानव समाज आज जिन परिस्थितियों से गुजर रहा है उससे हमारा किसी गंभीर चिंतन की ओर प्रवृत्त होना स्वाभाविक है। इस चिंतन के आयाम यूं तो अनेक हो सकते हैं, किंतु यदि किसी एक विषय की बात की जाए जिससे परे सृष्टि में कुछ है ही नहीं, जिससे जीव मात्र का जीवन और अस्तित्व समान रूप से जुड़े हुए हैं, तो वो है पंचमहाभूत। मध्य प्रदेश शासन के संस्कृति विभाग द्वारा साहित्य एवं कला विविधताओं पर आधारित गमक कार्यक्रम के अंतर्गत जिस व्याख्यान माला का आयोजन किया जा रहा है उसका विषय इसी तथ्य को दृष्टिगत रखते हुए निर्धारित किया गया है। ये विषय है सृष्टि सर्जना के नियामक पंचभूतादि तत्वों पर शास्त्रीय वैज्ञानिक विमर्श। आपके त्रिवेणी कला एवं पुरातत्व संग्रहालय द्वारा वर्चुअल प्लेटफॉर्म पर आपके लिए आयोजित की जा रही इस व्याख्यान माला के आज सत्र का विषय है पंचम और अंतिम वास्तुकला। आज की हमारी सम्माननीय वक्ता हैं श्रीमती स्नेहा नगरकर जी। आप सांस्कृतिक शिक्षा के प्रचार प्रसार के उद्देश्य से एक फोरम संचालित करती हैं तथा मुंबई विश्वविद्यालय के पुरातत्व विभाग की व्याख्याता हैं। आपके फोरम का नाम है पांचजन्य कल्चरल हेरिटेज इनिशिएटिव्स। आपने पुरातत्व की स्नातकोत्तर शिक्षा डेक्कन कॉलेज पुणे से संपन्न करी तथा मुंबई विश्वविद्यालय से देववाणी संस्कृत म्यूजियोलॉजी और इंडियन एस्थेटिक्स मतलब भारतीय सौंदर्य शास्त्र में डिप्लोमा प्राप्त किया है। आपके राष्ट्रीय व अंतर्राष्ट्रीय स्तर पर कई शोध पत्र प्रकाशित हैं और विशेषज्ञता आपको सनातन परंपरा की प्राचीन व मध्यकालीन वैष्णव धारा प्राचीन राजनैतिक व धार्मिक इतिहास आदि संबंधी विषयों में प्राप्त है। स्नेहा जी का अपना एक यूट्यूब चैनल भी है जिसके माध्यम से वे देश की परंपरा व इतिहास से समाज को परिचित कराने का अपना ध्येय अपना कर्तव्य पूर्ण करने का प्रयास कर रही हैं। तो हमारी मातृभूमि हमारे देश में एक से अधिक उद्देश्यों की पूर्ति हेतु जिन ऊर्जा पुंजों की जिन मंदिरों की स्थापना की गई है आज उन्हें एक स्ट्रक्चर मात्र से परे देखने में हम सक्षम पाएंगे। मैं आमंत्रित करती हूं श्रीमती स्नेहा नगरकर जी को, कृपया वे अपना व्याख्यान प्रारंभ करें। स्नेहा जी आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही है, शायद आप म्यूट है, एक बार प्लस चेक कर लीजिएगा।
सॉरी। नमस्ते, सभी श्रोताओं को मेरा प्रणाम। मैं सबसे पहले संस्कृति विभाग मध्य प्रदेश शासन तथा त्रिवेणी संग्रहालय की बहुत बहुत ऋणी हूँ कि उन्होंने मुझे अपने विचार प्रस्तुत करने की का ये अवसर दिया है। मैं डॉक्टर
अभी भी आपकी आवाज आ नहीं पा रही।
अभी मैं अनम्यूट पे बात करती हूँ। सभी श्रोताओं को मेरा प्रणाम। मैं संस्कृति विभाग मध्य प्रदेश शासन तथा त्रिवेणी संग्रहालय उज्जैन के विश्वस्तों की बहुत बहुत ऋणी हूँ कि उन्होंने मंदिर स्थापत्य और पंचमहाभूत इस विषय पर मेरे विचार प्रस्तुत करने की का करने का अवसर मुझे प्रदान किया। मैं डॉक्टर मीनाक्षी जोशी जी का भी बहुत बहुत आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ उनके और उनके प्रति कि उन्होंने मुझे ये अवसर प्रदान किया। शायद वो नहीं है अभी, पर मैं उनको भी उनके प्रति भी आभार व्यक्त करती हूँ। मेरी हिंदी इतनी अच्छी नहीं है इसलिए मैं इंग्लिश में लेक्चर दूंगी, पर बीच बीच में मैं हिंदी में बात करने की जरूर कोशिश करूँगी, प्रयास करूँगी। धन्यवाद। मैं मेरे व्याख्यान का आरम्भ कर रही हूँ। Is the screen visible? Screen दिख रहा है मैडम?
जी दिख रहा है।
दिख रहा है। तो आज मेरे व्याख्यान का विषय है पंच महाभूत और मंदिर स्थापत्य, पंच महाभूतास एंड टेंपल आर्किटेक्चर। द वर्ड भूत मीन्स दैट विच इज प्रोड्यूस्ड और दैट विच हैज बिकम। In Indian philosophy, the term Bhuta refers to the five fundamental elements, that is the Pancha Mahabhutas. They are Prithvi, Aap, Tejas or Agni, Vayu and Akasha. The permutations and combinations of these five लीड टू द क्रिएशन ऑफ आर फिजिकल यूनिवर्स, हमारा जो ब्रह्मांड है उसकी निर्मिति के पीछे ये पांच महाभूत है, ये पंच महाभूत है। एक मिनट, एंड क्रिएशन जो सृष्टि की उत्पत्ति है टेक्स प्लेस आउट ऑफ दीज स्थूल भूतज और महाभूतज। इन द तैतिरीय उपनिषद देर इज अ सेक्शन नोन एज द ब्रह्मानंदवल्ली, एंड इन द ब्रह्मानंदवल्ली इट इज सेड दैट फ्रॉम द सेल्फ कम्स स्पेस, फ्रॉम स्पेस एयर, from air fire, from fire water, from water earth, from earth come the plants and herbs, from plants and herbs comes food, and from food comes a human being. This is the chain, this is the link of creation which is given in the Brahmanandavalli of the Taittiriya Upanishad. Coming to the topic of temple architecture, one thing I would like to specify that building a temple is also a process of creation. ये एक निर्मिति का एक process है. So, obviously, the pancha mahabhutas are an integral aspect of temple architecture. According to Stella Kramreich, was a very eminent art historian, and she has written two volumes on the Hindu temple. And till today, these two books are considered as authorities on Hindu temple architecture. So there she says that the Hindu temple has Vaidika origins and has been inspired from the early forms of architecture. Generally, temples are found in places of pilgrimage. I just saw the documentary which was being played about Ujjaini, and when I was watching that documentary, I realized that Ujjaini or Avantika is a very important pilgrimage center. And it is also one of the Sapta Mokshadayini Puris of India. This tradition has been recorded in the Garuda Purana. And I was not aware that there are so many temples in Ujjaini. I was, of course, aware about the Mahakala temple and the ashram of Rishi Sandipani. But it was a great learning experience for me to watch that documentary. So, places of pilgrimage are found throughout India, and they are known as Tirtha and Kshetra. Tirtha is the name of a pilgrimage site which is located on the banks of a river, lake, or seashore. Tirtha is derived from the Sanskrit root tru, which means to cross. So Tirtha means a ford or a passage. So Tirtha is actually such a place which helps you to cross the Bhavasagara or the Bhavabdi. Kshetra is a sacred site or field with high potency. And Tirthas and Kshetras in India have a certain energy where a divine presence can be felt. Ek special urja hoti hai तीर्थ क्षेत्रों में, ऐसे माना गया है। A Hindu temple is a house and body of God and is based on the Vastu Purusha Mandala. कुछ जो धार्मिक परंपराएं हैं, there are some religious traditions where a religious place is considered to be a place of a prayer or congregational prayer. कि सब लोग इकट्ठे होकर प्रार्थना करते हैं, ऐसा वो स्थल होता है, पर जो हिंदू मंदिर है उसे भगवान का घर माना गया है। इट इज कॉल्ड द हाउस एंड द बॉडी ऑफ गॉड, एंड द हिंदू टेम्पल इज बेस्ड ऑन द वास्तु पुरुष मंडल। द वास्तु पुरुष मंडल इज अ स्क्वेयर डायग्राम विथ सेगमेंट्स एंड डायगनल्स। ड्रॉइंग इट एक्यूरेटली इज द फर्स्ट स्टेप in the science of architecture. The whole architecture of the temple is dependent on the Vastu Purusha Mandala. Purusha is the prime entity from which everything originates. Vastu is the site एंड इन इट रिसाइड्स द वस्तु एंड फ्रॉम वस्तु कम्स द नेम वास्तु. द पुरुष इज रिप्रेजेंटेड इन सब्सटेंस और बॉडीली फॉर्म इन द एक्चुअल स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द टेम्पल इन वुड स्टोन और ब्रिक. ऐसे माना गया है कि जो मंदिर है द टेम्पल दैट वी हैव, आई मीन इट कुड बी बिल्ट ऑफ वुड, इट कुड बी बिल्ट ऑफ स्टोन और ब्रिक्स और एनी मटीरियल फॉर दैट मैटर, दैट इज द बॉडी ऑफ द गॉड एंड द इमेज विच इज प्लेस्ड इनसाइड द टेम्पल इज द आत्मन और द सोल ऑफ द गॉड. ऐसे माना गया है. सो I will repeat again, the Purusha is represented in substance or bodily form in the actual structure of the temple in wood, stone or brick. And the temple is regarded as a place where there is a union or marriage of heaven and earth. So a temple is a place where there is a marriage or union of heaven and earth.
Gentle reminder, if you want to move the slides, because it is still at the welcome slide only.
Oh, it hasn't moved? Oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm... Oh. Okay, one minute.
Yeah, it's okay.
I didn't realize that, and the slides were moving at my end. 1 minute. Is it moving now?
Yes.
It's moving now?
Yes, now it is moving. That's what I was wondering, because I thought you have moved far ahead.
Yes. Okay, so I will now, what I will do is I will keep the screen like this. I will not put it on full screen because it is causing some problem. I will keep the screen like this.
It's okay.
Yeah, so thank you for letting me know. Should I repeat what I have just said or should I go ahead?
You may please go ahead, but let the screen...
I'll keep the screen like this. Okay. So I stopped where we were discussing that the temple is a place where there is a marriage of heaven and earth. According to Stella Kramreich, the temple is built in the likeness of the universe and is its reduced image. This is very important. And the temple is actually considered to be a mini cosmos. The temple is actually considered to be a small or a mini cosmos, a smaller version of the cosmos that we have around. And the science of architecture, if we see, which is known as Sthapatya Shastra Veda, is considered to be an Upa Veda. And Jyotisha and the Kalpa Vedangas are essential contents of the Hindu science of architecture. As we all know, Vedangas are the six limbs of the Vedas, and they are learning the Vedangas is extremely necessary if we want to study the Vedas. The Shulva Sutras, which are a part of the Kalpa Sutras, give the instructions for the proportionate measurement and construction of the Vaidika altar, for the Yajnas. And the Hindu temple is based on this principle. That is, the architecture of the Hindu temple is based on the architecture of the Vaidika altar. Of course, it is on a much larger scale, but it is based on the architecture, the building of the Vaidika altar. The principles on which the science of Vastu Shastra or Vastu Vidya was based are, I'll just discuss them a little so that we can understand the Vastu Shastra better. First is the surrounding atmosphere of the structure. Then the second quality is the quality of the soil where a structure stands. Third is shape and attributes of the soil and the direction which the building faces. This is very important. Then fourth is the ground plan of the building to be constructed. Fifth are the measurements. Then sixth are the dimensions of the various constituents of a structure and their relative proportions. Seventh are the consequences of the building of a structure on the builder or the yajamana. Then eighth is classification of residential houses, religious structures, pillars, gateways, and moldings. Ninth are the sanitary arrangements. Then 10th are the materials to be used for the building construction. Then 11th are the decorative elements. Then 12th is the distribution of a land to its suitable residents and purpose. Then comes planning of towns and villages. Many of our ancient texts on architecture have details about town planning, starting right from Kautilya's Arthashastra up to Samarangana Sutradhara, Mayamatam. All these texts have very detailed instructions on how a town has to be planned. Then the next one is temples and subsidiary buildings around the main temple. Then technique used in house construction. 16th is stability of a structure. And ceremonies and rituals related to Indian architecture. So these are some of the principles which underlie the discipline of Vastuvidya. Now we come to the Pancha Mahabhutas and temple architecture. So first we will deal with the earth or Prithvi. The fundamental principle of Vastu Shastra is the site on which the house or temple has to be constructed. The Vaidika texts like the Rigveda, they invoke the earth as Dridha, that is stable. Shatapatha Brahmana says that the earth is firmly established. Texts like the Vajasaniya Samhita and the Taittiriya Samhita regard the earth as a goddess and she is prayed to so that she may stand firm for our, that is the people's welfare. The earth becomes firm and thus becomes a reliable support for the structure which is to be constructed or the structure which is going to stand on it. And there are a number of ways which have been prescribed to test the quality of the earth. There are certain rituals which are prescribed during the Shilanyasa ritual, and there are certain rituals which are performed when the last stone is placed on the superstructure of the temple. Also, before the installation of the principal image and before the ritual of opening its eyes, there are a set of rituals. Now, before the piling up of the sacrificial altar, the ploughing and sowing of the sacrificial ground was done. And through this ritual, the germ or garbha of the temple is deposited in the earth. So even before the construction of a temple, the land selected would be ploughed and seeds would be sown in it. And this indicated that the germ or garbha of the temple is deposited in the earth. According to Stella Kramreich, the structure of the temple that grows from this germ absorbs the essence of the earth and transmutes it. Its shape is produced from the power of the earth, that is Bhu, and its form corresponds to the plan laid on its leveled surface, that is Bhumi. Ploughing of the land marks a new beginning, a new creation. And the earth is ploughed a number of times and eventually leveled for the drawing of the Vastu Purusha Mandala. Prithvi is the leveled ground from which the temple will arise. Leveling of the earth like this is considered as a continuity of Prithuvanya's emphasis on the establishment of order in a world full of anarchy and chaos. Prithuvanya's story has been discussed in many of our Puranas, like for example the Hari Vamsha Purana. हमारे बहुत से पुराणों में पृथ्वीवन्य की कथा आई है और किस तरह उन्होंने पृथ्वी का दोहन किया और लोगों को वार्ता प्रदान की, शहर बनाए, रास्ते बनाए, वाणिक पथ बनाए, ये सब डिटेल्स हमें पुराणों में मिलते हैं. Our texts speak of four things as vastu. First is bhumi, that is the ground. Then the second is prasada. Prasada means a temple or a palace. Third is yana, the conveyance. आप जिससे travel करते हैं वो. और and the fourth is shayana or a couch. Bhu is the main vastu. And that is the substratum of the entire existence. Those which originate from the earth are called vastus, they are called prasadas, and they are the dwelling places. Bhu, that is the earth, is mentioned first in the Mayamatam and even other works on architecture, and it is the first of the elements, bhuta, and supports the world. So panchamahabhuton mein prithvi sabse pehli hai kyunki wo pure vishv ko dharan karti hai. As per the pauranika vastu shanti prayoga, the body of the vastu purusha rests under all dwellings. His head is placed to carry the burden of the earth. All sites are filled with his presence, whether it is towns, cities, temples, palaces, houses, tanks, wells, all of them are filled with the presence of the Vastu Purusha. The Yajamana who performs the sacrifice is identified with the Prajapati himself. And it is also believed that in building the sacrificial altar, the Yajamana becomes the altar himself. And the symbolism of the Vaidika altar is carried ahead in the Hindu temple in its plan. Now, even later on, a person who patronized a temple construction was also considered to be the Yajamana, because construction of a temple was considered equal to the performance of a sacrifice. कि एक मंदिर को बांधना, एक मंदिर की निर्मिति करना भी एक यज्ञ के समान माना गया. Vastushpati is the lord of a structure, and the earth is like its mistress. The earth is the soil. The Vastushpati leaves his mark on her, and she accepts his seed. This is the meaning behind the Ankurarpana and the Garbhadhana rituals, which are performed before the construction of a temple. Now, coming to the materials used for temple constructions, we must remember that they all represent the earth. Whether it is stone, whether it is brick, whether it is wood, we derive all these building materials from the earth, and her presence is there in all these building materials. So starting with the Brihat Samhita, that is Varahamihira's Brihat Samhita, their materials for construction have been given, and these include burnt bricks, wood, and stone. Prasada is the most common term used for a temple. Other terms which denote a temple have also been used, like Suralaya, Surabhavana, Devalaya, Devayatana, Devakula, Devagraha, Devagara, and Ayatana. And the term Mandira is used to indicate a residential building and not a temple. Varahamihira has recommended the use of bricks and stone for temple architecture, as they are more durable, and especially stone, because stone is more durable than a brick structure. He has also given the details of an ideal site for a temple. So he says that the site which you select for a temple construction should be full with water. It should be replete with water, trees, and groves. Ideal sites for temple construction should be in the vicinity of forests, rivers, and mountains. Then we come to the Matsya Purana. The Matsya Purana has recommended specific types of land for the specific varnas. For example, land with a white colored soil is considered good for the Brahmana Varna. The Matsya Purana has an entire adhyaya which gives the details regarding the use of suitable wood in the construction of houses. Then we come to the Vishnu Dharmottara Purana. The Vishnu Dharmottara Purana is an Upa Purana, which is affiliated to the Vishnu Purana. And this text gives us details about what kind of trees have to be used in temple construction and from where the wood has to be brought. For example, trees growing in a smashana or in a temple should not be used. Trees which are short in height and crooked should not be used. And he also gives a list of auspicious trees like Nandana, Sandana, Shala, Khadira, Kimshuka, Padmaka, Haridra, etc. Now the Vishnu Dharmottara Purana has also given the qualities of stones which have to be used in temple construction. According to this text, stones which have animals living in it should be avoided. Rituals are prescribed for the choosing of the right stone. The stones brought for temple construction after performing the prescribed rituals lead to happiness. Different colored clays have been prescribed for the four different varnas. And the clays which has to be used should be brought from unmixed and auspicious ground, and it should be then dried. Dried clay should be mixed with water and shaivala and then burnt with dry wood, cow dung, and grass. Then we come to bricks. Bricks and wood were commonly employed, but they are not durable. Bricks have been used in construction. Yes? Any problem? Hello?
I think he has not muted himself. So you please continue.
Yeah, okay. So bricks have been used since the times of the Sindhu Saraswati civilization. Many of the well-known... I think somebody is not muted.
Others who have not kept themselves on mute, I request them to keep themselves on mute. जिन्होंने म्यूट नहीं कर रखा है प्लीज वक्ता के अलावा सभी लोग अपना मोबाइल या कंप्यूटर म्यूट कर लें. सदाशिव मिश्रा जी
ओके. सो मेनी ऑफ द वेल नोन साइट्स ऑफ द सिंधु सरस्वती सिविलाइजेशन वेदर इट इज राखी गढ़ी और हरप्पा मोहिंजोदारो or Lothal, bricks have been used on a large scale, and they were mostly burnt bricks. And in archaeology, when we are studying the process of urbanization, we have been told that the use of burnt bricks indicates some level of urbanization. Bricks are considered the body of the sacrifice. They are called Yajna Tanu. And detailed descriptions are given in texts about the making of baked bricks. Act of offering goes into the creation of the brick. The material of the brick is its carrier, and the earth and the fire are the elements which participate in it and enable the Yajamana to construct his sacrificial body. The bricks themselves are considered to be oblations to the Prajapati. Bricks are burnt bricks. Baked bricks are made by using fire. Whatever oblation they offered to Prajapati transformed into a burnt brick, and as they were produced from the offering, that is Ishta, they came to be known as Ishtaka. Bricks are known as Ishtika or Ishtaka. And the bricks are therefore made by fire and they are the oblation. So the principle of the Mancha Mahabhuta or the Mahabhuta of Agni is also present in baked bricks. Then we come to the Agni Purana. The negative elements in the chosen piece of land should be driven out through rituals, and that is how the land is purified. According to the Agni Purana, the Vastu Purusha was a fearful being and he was put in the earth by the Devatas. The list of deities placed in the different parts of the Vastu Purusha Mandala are similar to the Matsya Purana, and the Agni Purana has also prescribed rituals for the worship of these deities. Then we come to the Samarangana Sutradhara of Raja Bhoja Paramara. Raja Bhoja Paramara has given details about different kinds of lands in the 9th chapter of the Samarangana Sutradhara. This chapter is named Bhumi Pariksha. Bricks which are not properly baked should not be used. Once the bricks are ready, they have to be arranged in a proper manner and at a proper place. Bricks must be joined together with Vajralepa. So Vajralepa is like the binding material, and this applies to stone as well. Then we come to Mayamatam. The Mayamatam has listed the four kinds of dwelling sites. We have already seen what those are. And the earth is considered to be the primary dwelling place. And it is because of the earth that built dwellings, vastu like temples, have come into existence. So the earth is the primary site. The Mayamatam has also prescribed different kinds of dwelling sites for the different Varanas. Qualities of these sites have also been mentioned. In sites meant for Brahmanas and gods, the shape of the site must be the site should be filled with fragrance of flowers like Pumnaga, jasmine, lotus, grain, and patala. It should be capable of producing all kinds of grains. Basically, it should be a fertile land. Then the ground which is to be used for the temple construction should be free from potsherds, pebbles, worms, insects, bones, holes, charcoal, stumps, pointed objects, sludge, dust, cavities, and husks, and it as well as covered in white sand. And such kind of a ground is suitable for all the classes and it gives success. So basically, in the temple, when a temple is being constructed, one of the basic concerns was that the temple which is being constructed should be auspicious for the Yajamana, because the Yajamana is doing it for procuring punya, for procuring religious merit. So obviously the temple should be auspicious for its builder and not otherwise. And the Mayamatam says that wood, stone and brick are to be used for vertical elements like pillars and horizontal elements like architraves. According to the Mayamatam, trees grown in holy places, mountains or river bank should be used, and they should give pleasure to the eyes and the mind. So even the Mayamatham has discussed the kind of wood that one must use in temple construction. Then, as far as stones are concerned, the Mayamatham has prescribed the use of stones of even color. They should be hard, perfect, and touching these stones should give a pleasant experience. They should be embedded in the earth with an eastward or northward orientation. Then, as far as bricks are concerned, Mayamatham says that the bricks should not have any defect. They should be compact and uniformly baked. And when a structure is built using such compact and uniformly baked bricks, it is favorable for the growth of dharma, artha, and kama. So temple construction is also related to the purusharthas. Then we come to the Manasara. Manasara is a very important text on temple construction and architecture in general, not just temple construction, but architecture in general. And it's in its third chapter, we have the details about the building materials and other things and the testing of the ground. So the mansion and other buildings are called Vastu because they are connected to the ground, that is Vastu. The earth becomes the dwelling place of all beings because of the sun. The sun is the giver of energy. And even in this text, it is said that the ground is tested on the basis of color, odor, features, sound, taste, and touch. Like other texts which we have seen, the Manasara has also prescribed different kinds of ground for the different varnas. Quadrangular ground, which is elevated towards the south, is suitable for the dwelling place of the gods, that is a temple. The Manasara also gives details about trees and animals associated with such kind of land. And it also says that there should be a pond towards the southern side. So here comes the element of apa or water. It also gives details about what kind of ground should be avoided, ground which should not be used for the construction of dwellings. Details about soil examination are also given, and the land should be plowed by oxen. And the text goes into such details that it also says what kind of oxen should be used. So features of oxen used for plowing purposes have also been given. Then coming to the Vishwakarma Prakasha, the ground on which a temple is to be built should be of a high quality. It should be tested on the basis of smell, color, and taste, and it should not have too many depressions. Only such kind of a ground will produce auspicious effects after the temple has been constructed. Now, it has also given gradings. Okay, so a temple built out of stone will give 10 times the merit compared to a temple built out of clay. Prasadas built out of copper, silver, and gold give more merit consecutively. And this text has also given details about the rite of Shilanyasa. So here we will see a few images. So this is an image of the famous Lomasa Rishi cave, which was excavated under the patronage of Emperor Ashoka in the Khalatika Hills. The Khalatika Hills are the modern Barabar caves near Bodh Gaya. So Ashoka got these caves excavated for the ascetics of the Ajivika sect. So here also stone has been used as a dwelling place, and these caves are said to be copies of wooden architecture. So this crisscross pattern that you see here is a copy of the wooden architecture. This is the famous Chaitya Ghara at the site of Bhaja. The site of Bhaja is located in the state of Maharashtra. It is near Lonavala. Lonavala is a hill station near the city of Pune. And this Chaitya Ghara at Bhaja is considered to be one of the oldest Chaitya Gharas in Maharashtra. So this is a Buddhist site. It has a stupa, and this has also been excavated out of rock. It has been excavated out of rock, and it is one of the oldest rock cut structures in Maharashtra, and even in India for that matter. Then this is a cave at Badami, which was excavated under the patronage of the Chalukya rulers, of Vatapi or Badami. Contemporary to this cave, we have the caves excavated under the regimes of the Pallava rulers, Mahendra Varman and his son Narasimha Varman Pallava. And this is a cave from the famous site of Mahabalipuram. And these caves were excavated under the patronage of Narasimha Varman, who was also known as Mahamalla or Mahabali. The town of Mahabalipuram is named after him. Some people even say that was his capital, though actually the capital of the Pallavas was Kanchipuram. Then we come to the famous Kailasa temple at Ellora. Ellora is a place near Aurangabad in the state of Maharashtra. And this entire temple of Kailasa, which is dedicated to Shiva, has been excavated out of rock. It has not been constructed. So this is also an expression of the Mahabhuta of Prithvi. And this was the work of this temple started during the reign of King Krishna of the Rashtrakuta dynasty. And this is the largest monolithic edifice. This is the largest monolithic building in India. And it represents the zenith of rock cut architecture in India. The style of this temple is similar to the Dravidian temples. And some scholars even state that this temple has affinity to temples at Pattadakal in Karnataka. So this is like the largest rock cut monument in India. Then we also had structures which were made out of wood. Here we have a relief sculpture from Sanchi. And here we can see that there are these hut-like structures. Some of them have the Chaitya Gavaksha windows, the Chaitya Gavakshas and the Shala type of Shikharas. Okay? And they are small structures, but they are definitely religious structures because here we can see people praying to them. So in all probability, these structures were also made out of wood. At least the superstructures were made out of wood. This is another example from Sanchi itself about a religious building. And we can see buntings which have been, which are decorating this building, which have been hung from this building. And the building has the Chaitya Gavakshas. This is the famous temple number 17 at Sanchi, which is considered to be the oldest existing structural temple in North India. So it has a very simple kind of an architecture, a mandapa, a pillared mandapa with a square garbhagruha. As you can see, there is no shikhara on this temple. And this in all probability is a Buddhist temple. Though there is no image in the garbhagruha now. And this is the famous Rudra Narasimha temple from the site of Ramtek. Ramtek is a hill near the city of Nagpur in Maharashtra. And this Rudra Narasimha temple belongs to the Vakataka dynasty. And in all probability, it was built by Rudrasena II, the Vakataka ruler, who was married to Prabhavati Gupta. Prabhavati Gupta was the daughter of Chandragupta II, Vikramaditya. And even if you observe this temple, first of all, it is built on a jagati, a platform. It is built of stone and there is no shikhara. This is the famous temple of Devgarh. This is also known as the Dashavatara temple. It's a Vaishnava temple. And this temple is specially known for its sculptures. It is dated to the early part of the 6th century CE. And we can see that a temple tower, a shikhara, in a very rudimentary form, was there as far as this temple is concerned. This is also built out of stone. And this is the famous Shore Temple at Mahabalipuram. There are two temples here. And these are also one of the earliest structural temples, one of the earliest existing structural temples in Tamil Nadu. Some scholars have even said that this is the oldest structural temple in Tamil Nadu. It is the oldest example of structural Dravidian architecture. Here we have the famous Kandariya Mahadeva temple of Khajuraho, and this is also built of stone, sandstone. And this temple in a way represents the zenith of North Indian temple architecture, which is also known as the Nagara style of temple architecture. So this is Khajuraho is a World Heritage Site. And as you can see, temple architecture in stone was fully developed by the 10th, 11th centuries of the Common Era. Then we come to the Bhitargaon temple. The speciality of the Bhitargaon temple is that it is built of bricks. So we don't have many examples of brick temples, but this is one very important example of a brick temple. This is also dated to the Gupta period, and it has sculptures of various deities, various Hindu deities here on its walls. Then we come to the second Mahabhuta, and that is water. Water, as we all know, is a purifying agent. It is responsible for fertility and regeneration. Texts like Varaha Mihira's Brihat Samhita and the Bhavishya Purana stress on the presence of water in the form of river, lake, or a spring near the site of a temple. Varaha Mihira even says that deities come near spots which are furnished with water and groves. They may be natural or man-made. As per the Vishnu Dharmottara Purana, images of deities must be consecrated in places where there is a water body, forests, hilltops, and caves. And where there are no tanks, where there is no water body, the gods do not dwell. So we already know that take any Tirtha Kshetra in India. It has a water body in its vicinity. We take the example of Dwarka. Dwarka is located on the sea coast. We take the example of Puri. Puri is located on the sea coast. We take the example of Ujjaini, located on the banks of the Kshipra. We take the example of Mathura and Vrindavan, which are located on the banks of the Yamuna. Or the best example is Varanasi, on the banks of the Ganga. So all our sacred sites have some water body or the other in its vicinity. You can take the example of Pushkar, which is located on the banks of a lake. So some kind of water body is always present in a Tirtha Kshetra. A temple should not be constructed where there is a pond on the left. A temple should be constructed where there is a pond on the left or front and not anywhere else. And if a temple is built on an island, the water from all sides is considered holy. So the presence of water is extremely essential when a temple building construction is taken up, or when a temple building activity is taken up. Now, Varuna is the presiding deity of the waters, and he is invoked when an image is being consecrated in a temple. If no water source is available nearby, then 3 pots of water are placed in the Brahmasthana or the center of the sacred site on which the temple is to be built. Then there is also a concept of the Vastu Nara, and the right side face of the Vastu Nara is supposed to be made of water, that is Apa, and his eye, one of his eyes, represents the god Parjanya. Parjanya, as you all know, is a Vedic deity. Urban centers where these features may be absent, like a natural lake or a river, excavation of water tanks and laying of gardens were to be taken up. The gods are said to be easily accessible in spots where there is a presence of water and gardens. They may be natural or man-made. So we know that many ancient temples are found in the vicinity of ponds, lakes, or rivers. Temples of Bhuvaneshwara, Puri, and Konark had tanks very close by. We have Paniya Podis. I will show you a picture of that. Paniya Podis in Buddhist rock cut caves. Paniya Podis were water cisterns from which water was used for drinking purposes. There is also a huge water cistern in the main cave temple at Elephanta. Elephanta is a World Heritage Site. It is located on an island near Mumbai. They are all Shaiva caves and they are a World Heritage Site. Then as per the Agni Purana, a temple should be constructed in Tirthas like Kurukshetra, Gaya and near a river. The best site for a temple is a place where there is a large sheet of water in the front and trees and groves all around. Kautilya's Arthashastra states that the king must have his capital at the confluence of rivers or a lake or a tank. And we all know that the capital of the Mauryas, that is the city of Pataliputra, was located on the banks of the river Ganga. Texts indicate that temples should be constructed near tanks which have sweet and transparent water. Most ancient temples, they may be under active worship or otherwise, are located near tanks. So they have tanks in their vicinity. Also, we have the concept of Lokapalas and Dikpalas, and their Varuna, who represents water, is the Lokapala of the Western Quarter. Then we have images of Ganga and Yamuna at the Dwarashakhas of temples. This is seen both in rock cut temples as well as structural temples. And we also have images of Ganga and Yamuna on the Dwarashakhas of the Buddhist caves at Ajanta. They are also there in the Shaiva cave at Jogeshwari. Jogeshwari is a suburb of Mumbai, and there is a Pashupata Shaiva cave, and there also on one of its entrances we have the depiction of Ganga and Yamuna. And these rivers are considered to be symbols of purity and fertility. They are considered to be purifying agents, and they are also a symbol of fertility, fecundity, and regeneration. So even, I'm digressing a little, but we have the representation of the river Ganga even on the coins of Emperor Kumaragupta the First. Emperor Kumaragupta was the son of Chandragupta the Second, Vikramaditya. So even on the coins of Kumaragupta the First, we have the depiction of the river Ganga. So here, this is the entrance to the famous Kailasa temple at Ellora. I just spoke about it. So here we can see the river goddess Ganga, who is shown on her mount Makara. The Makara is the vehicle of Ganga, and the tortoise or Kashyapa is the vehicle or the mount of the river Yamuna. Inside the Kailasa temple also we have the representation of these river goddesses. So here is an image of the river goddess Ganga standing on her mount Makara. Then this is the river goddess Yamuna, who is standing on her mount, that is a tortoise. And here we have the river goddess Saraswati, who is shown standing on a lotus. So these goddess figures have been carved very close to the entrance of the Kailasa temple, and all the three rivers have been represented here. Then this is another image of river Ganga from one of the caves at Ellora, one of the Shaiva caves at Ellora. So here you can see Ganga standing on her mount Makara. It is a highly stylized form of the Makara, but she is gracefully standing on her mount. This is an image of the god Varuna, who is the Dikpal of the western direction, and even his Vahana is Makara, and here you can see him holding the Pasha. So Varuna and the other Dikpalas and the other seven Dikpalas, they were represented on the temple walls. So this is also an integration of the water element. This is another figure of Varuna. This is from the Rajarani temple at Bhuvaneshwar, and here very gracefully we can see that Varuna is standing and he holds a Pasha in his right hand, sorry, in his left hand. So this is a water cistern from the rock cut cave complex of Bhaja, and this was given as a donation. Many people would donate water cisterns to the Buddhist monasteries. That is, they would give money for the excavation of water cisterns to the Buddhist monasteries. This is a temple from the site of Badami or the ancient Vatapi, and this water body that you see here in the foreground is the famous Agastya Tirtha at Badami. This is a small water tank near the temple of Ambarnatha. Ambarnatha is a suburb near Mumbai, and it has a beautiful Shilahara period Bhumija Shiva temple. The temple was constructed in 1060 CE. And just next to the temple is this beautiful Pushkarani, which dates back to the same period as the temple. So most temples, especially from the early medieval period onwards, had tanks in their vicinity. Then we come to the Mahabhuta of fire or Agni. Vastu Purusha, one of the opinions is that Vastu Purusha of the plan of the temple is Agni Prajapati. There are different names for the Vastu Purusha. One of the ancient names is Vastoshpati, and he is considered to be the son of Rudra Prajapati and the Dawn, and he is equated with Grahapati or Agni. Agni is considered to be the giver and protector of dwellings. Prajapati, Soma and Agni, all these three gods are invoked as Grahapati. And the epithet of Vasu, that is the one who bestows a dwelling, or Grahapati in the Rigveda, was applied to Agni, Soma and the Maruts. The Ashtadikpalas, as per the Amara Kosha, begin from the east, are Indra, Agni, Yama, Nriti, Varuna, Maruta, Kubera and Ishana. Agni in the earlier texts was considered to be the protector of the northeast direction, but later texts state that Agni was the guardian of the southeast direction. In the 81 squares which form a part of the Vastu Purusha Mandala diagram, devatas like Parjanya, Surya, Vayu, Apa and Agni are also to be worshipped. As per the Agni Purana, there should be a temple of Agni and the Matrukas in the Agniya quarter. And a yajna or sacrifice was also an important part of the process of house and temple construction. We have yajnashalas which have been discovered in the rock cut caves at Ellora. Also, I have already spoken about baked bricks. Agni is integral, is essential for the manufacturing of, for the making of baked bricks. And sunlight is also considered to be a form of fire or Agni. And we, as we all know, we require sunlight for our growth. दिस इज एन इमेज ऑफ अग्नि फ्रॉम द टेम्पल एट अंबरनाथ, फ्रॉम द शिव टेम्पल एट अंबरनाथ. This is another image of Agni from the Rajarani temple at Bhuvaneshwar. Agni is generally shown with a pot belly and a beard, and his Vahana, the ram, can be seen here, and flames are emerging out of his body. This is a very beautiful sculpture of Agni, very detailed and intricate. Then we come to Vayu. Vayu is derived from the root which means to go, to move, and for the circulation of vayu, that is air, vatayanas or windows would be made in temples, and balconies and windows or openings would be provided in temples for the circulation of air and light. So there would be windows and balconies for the circulation or proper circulation of air and light. Then we come to the Mahabhuta of Akasha. Akasha, as we know, is all pervasive. According to some scholars, the temple tower, the Shikhara, represents a move towards the Akasha, and the open spaces in the temples like terraces, courtyards, they indicate the presence of the Mahabhuta of Akasha. This is an opinion of some scholars. As per the Shilpa Shastras, now I'm coming to the conclusion of my lecture. As per the Shilpa Shastras, the base of a temple is called Panchakarma, and it has the representation of the Pancha Mahabhutas. As per the Shilpa Shastras, on this part of the image, we have the Gajathara or the Gajapatta, which is always at the bottom, and Hamsathara or Hamsapatta or swan band, which is on the top. Gaja represents Bhumi and Hamsa represents Akasha. The Simhapatta, that is the lion band, and the Ashwapatta, that is the horse band, represent the aspect of Surya, and they both represent Agni. The Makara Patta represents Varuna, and as we have seen, Makara is a Vahana of the river Ganga and of the Dikpal Varuna, and the Patra Patta represents Vayu. So this is the Gajathara from the Buddhist cave at the cave complex of Karle. Karle is also located near Lonavala, near Pune in Maharashtra, and here at the base of the cave temple, the main Chaitya Ghara, we can see these rows of elephants. These are elephants. This is the Gajathara from the Kailasa temple at Ellora. You can see these elephants here. Then this is a representation of the different tharas or pattas from the Hoysaleshwar temple at Halebidu. So we have the Gajapatta, the Simhapatta, the Patrapatta, and the Ashwathara here, Ashwapatta here. The Gajathara, the Simhathara, the Patrathara, and the Ashwathara. And here again, we have the representation of the Makara Patta and the Hamsa Patta. This is also from the Hoysaleshwar temple at Halebidu. So lastly, I would just like to say that for a temple or for any building to be auspicious, we need to follow the rules of Vastu Vidya, and we need a perfect balance of all the Panchamahabhutas, and that is how we can ensure the auspiciousness and sacredness of the structure to be built. Thank you so much.
Sneha ji, सर्वप्रथम आपको बहुत-बहुत धन्यवाद. अपने व्याख्यान के माध्यम से आपने हमें मंदिर विज्ञान में, मंदिरों की स्थापना में जो गूढ़ ज्ञान मेहत है, उससे परिचित कराने का प्रयास किया। साथ ही हमारे आज के सभी सुधीर श्रोताओं को मैं आमंत्रित करती हूँ कि अपनी जिज्ञासा प्रश्न के रूप में आज के हमारे वक्ता के सामने वे प्रस्तुत कर सकते हैं। इफ एनीबडी हैज एनी क्वेश्चन टू अवर स्पीकर दे मे प्लीज आस्क, और इफ दे आर हेजिटेंट और इफ दे हैव एनी प्रॉब्लम विद माइक और समथिंग दे मे पुट देयर क्वेश्चन इन द चैट बॉक्स।
मैडम मुझे एक क्वेश्चन पूछना है।
जी मैडम।
हाँ, ये मुझे ऐसा पूछना है कि जो सूर्य मंदिर है
कोणार्क का,
कोणार्क का, हाँ, तो वहां पे वो बस वो उसी दिन वो सूर्य का प्रकाश वो भगवान सूर्य के ऊपर आता है उसका, यानी कि क्या विज्ञान उसमें है? एक और एक शायद कन्याकुमारी का जो स्वामी विवेकानंद जी का है
शिला स्मारक,
हाँ, वहाँ भी शायद उनके पैरों पर उसी दिन पे आता है सूर्य का किरण। और तीसरा जो मंदिर है, हाँ, कोल्हापुर की जो लक्ष्मी देवी का है वहां पे आता है, तो ये तीन जो स्थल है वहां का जो अलग अलग है, एक साउथ पे है और एक उधर ईशान्य पे आता है और ये कोल्हापुर इधर आता है थोड़ा पश्चिम में भारत के इसमें, तो क्या ऐसा उसका जो सूर्य के भ्रमण का जो है वो क्या है, थोड़ा सा आप बताएंगे तो अच्छा होगा।
I'm sorry, पर मैं इस प्रश्न का उत्तर नहीं दे पा रही हूँ क्योंकि मेरा विषय पुरातत्व है और ये थोड़ा मुश्किल मुझे लग रहा है, तो मैं आई एम सॉरी पर मैं इन सवालों का
नहीं, लेकिन हाँ ठीक है आपका पुरातत्व है, लेकिन लेकिन मैडम इस पर जो सूर्य की जो भ्रमण गति है और वही एक बिंदु ऐसा आता है कि वो सूर्य का किरण वो भगवान के चरण पर या वो मूर्ति पर आता है, तो वो जो दक्षिणायन उत्तरायण और सूर्य के किरण का जो उसमें विज्ञान है, तो आप पूरा तत्व वाली है तो थोड़ा सा फिर सोचना इस बारे में।
जी जी जरूर। हाँ। मैं एक्चुअली क्या है कि मैं ये सब चीजें पढ़ रही हूँ आजकल, तो मेरा उसपे प्रॉपर मास्टरी नहीं हुआ है, इसीलिए मैं आपको कुछ भी जवाब नहीं देना चाहती एक्चुअली।
नहीं, बिल्कुल बराबर है मैडम, और ये बात एक ध्यान में रखना है कि हमारे जो पुरातत्व का जो भी ये सब मंदिर है ये सब बनाए हैं, ये बहुत ही शास्त्रोक्त और उसको क्या बोलते हैं विज्ञान है, इसमें
बिल्कुल,
सही
बिल्कुल।
में विज्ञान है, तो ऐसा नहीं हो सकता है ना कि किसी भी दिन वो प्रकाश नहीं आता लेकिन उसी दिन में आता है,
विज्ञान है इसके पीछे में।
हाँ, तो वो हमें
भाग्यश्री जी, मैं यहाँ पर ये आपको कहना चाहूंगी, प्रश्न आपका बहुत सुंदर है और ये तथ्य सभी के सामने आने भी चाहिए, लेकिन मुझे लगता है हमारा जो ज्ञान है सनातन परंपरा में जितने भी तरह के ज्ञान धाराएं हैं ये अपने आप में बहुत बृहद है और ये बहुत इंटर रिलेटेड है, तो जब तक कि हमारा इंटरडिसिप्लिनरी अप्रोच नहीं होगा और हम एक विधा में पारंगत अगर होते हैं तो दूसरा छूटता है, ये एक जन्म जो है वो अपर्याप्त है हमें ये सारा ज्ञान।
बिल्कुल, एग्जैक्टली।
और आपका जो प्रश्न है वो मुझे लगता है खगोल विज्ञान से ज्यादा जुड़ा हुआ है बजाय कि मंदिर स्थापत्य के, हालांकि उसमें खगोल विज्ञान को मंदिर स्थापत्य में यूज किया गया है इन मंदिरों में जिनका आप काम कर रहे हैं, लेकिन उसका आधार खगोल विज्ञान है, एस्ट्रोलॉजिकल साइंस जो है दैट इज द बेस ऑफ द एग्जांपल्स व्हिच यू आर पुटिंग अप एंड इट इज नॉट रिलेटेड एग्जैक्टली एंड डायरेक्टली विद द टेम्पल आर्किटेक्चर।
यस यस, ठीक है, धन्यवाद मैडम।
Any more question, query? स्नेहा जी, आपने प्रेजेंटेशन के माध्यम से ये बताया इसलिए और काफी समझ में भी आया। मैं त्रिवेणी संग्रहालय के वर्चुअल टूर हेतु आप लोगों को आमंत्रित करती हूँ। यहाँ चैट बॉक्स में आप लोगों के लिए त्रिवेणी संग्रहालय की वर्चुअल टूर की लिंक पेस्ट की जा रही है। इट्स अ वेरी ब्यूटीफुल म्यूजियम एंड ड्यू टू दिस पैंडेमिक यू मे नॉट ऑल कम हियर बट आई इनवाइट यू फॉर द वर्चुअल टूर। त्रिवेणी संग्रहालय सनातन संस्कृति को कला के श्रेष्ठतम और सुंदरतम आयामों में प्रस्तुत करने का प्रयास कर रहा है। जैसा कि स्नेहा जी ने अभी अपने व्याख्यान में बताया कि प्राचीन संदर्भों में उल्लेखित सप्तपुरी उज्जैनी, मोक्षदायिनी उज्जैनी आपने अभी उल्लेख किया था गरुड़ पुराण का, तो यहीं पर त्रिवेणी संग्रहालय, ज्योतिर्लिंग महाकालेश्वर और शक्तिपीठ हरसिद्धि के निकट रुद्र तालाब के किनारे स्थित है। आप सभी को संग्रहालय के अवलोकनार्थ अपने परिवार और मित्रगणों के साथ हम आमंत्रित करते हैं। व्याख्यानमाला का अगला सत्र आगामी शनिवार को होगा, दिनांक 14 अगस्त 2021, समय यही दोपहर 4 बजे। हमारे अगले सत्र का विषय है आयुर्वेद में पंचमहाभूतों की अवधारणा, और हमारे सम्माननीय वक्ता होंगे श्री मुरली मनोहर पाठक जी। एक बार पुनः हमारी आज की वक्ता तथा सुधी श्रोताओं को मैं सादर आभार प्रकट करती हूँ। धन्यवाद।